What's up? So happy to see you guys. I'm Jennifer Begley, CEO of CI Web Group. We're here on today's Reinvent session. Today's title is titled The Loyalty Effect. And we have one of our most special friends, colleagues, partners, and downright have sat in the room eating ice cream for 100 hours, Mr. Casey Everhart, the Ideal Networker, who is an international speaker, spoke on tens of thousands of stages, and you can not anymore catch him jet setting over to Australia and anywhere and everywhere. Usually this man, I only get to see him when we're crossing paths in an airport, but I believe we have stayed home for the longest period of time in our history because of this thing called quarantine. Correct, Casey? Welcome. Thank you so much for joining.
Thank you. It's glad to be here, coming to you from my sweatpantcation.
So how many trips have you done in the last couple months?
None, and it's driving me crazy. This is the longest I've not been on an airport, in an airport, on an airplane, or in another city in about the past 15 years, and I'm, quite frankly, I'm over it.
So question, being home, being stationary, what has it done for your business? How much time do you spend working on it instead of in it?
What's been fantastic is this has given me all of those things in my business that I've said, oh, you know what, I'm going to get around to it, but I just have got some focus time, but I've just got some spare time, and it's allowed me to learn more, implement more, and generate more customers. So on the other side of this, my competitors are going to be kind of in the dust.
Man, that's real. I say thank you for this every moment. I'm not thankful to what caused it or what's happening across the globe, but I get to choose how we respond to it. And in our world, the way we're responding to it is, man, we're getting all the stuff we said we always should do but never have, and it is fantastic. So
I would say this, for all business owners, don't let a good crisis go to waste.
Right. This is when the majority of entrepreneurs, multimillionaires, and everyone who's ever done anything spectacular came about. This is it.
Yep.
Your time. So speaking of it, this is actually a perfect segue.
See,
you haven't seen the presentation at all, is to talk for just a minute about capacity. You guys, right now, everyone came to this webinar or is watching the recording webinar afterwards with some level of capacity for dealing with this. That capacity level is impacted by 101 things, but primarily how you were raised, what your influences are, how much news you watch. It's everything. I'm gonna refresh this because I want it to actually work, and internet's a little slow to respond. So that your capacity level has essentially been altered by everything that you have ever engaged in, which currently feeding your mind and so forth. Casey, I know you deal with people on a daily basis that come to the table with the glass completely full. On one hand, they say, I'm ready to get a different result. I don't love where I'm at. I want to do something different. I want better out of what I'm doing. And then on the flip side, glass totally full, come to a webinar like this, and I'm multitasking while I'm listening. I'm doing something different. Or I came saying, this isn't going to work from day one, or this is how I've always done it. What do you see the difference is? You take two people, one with the glass half full, one that says, you know what, I'm going to clear my glass, I'm going to come listen, and I'm going to implement what I learned afterwards.
Yeah, well, at the end of the day, Jim, and you're exactly right, I'll put it into a different context. Nothing is going to change until the pain of changing is less than the pain of staying the same. Right? So if you come to this and you are so filled with capacity that you can't even allow one extra molecule of energy into your business, you're going to get left in the dust. This is a game of emptying the glass, filling it, emptying the glass, filling it, and continuously improving, continuously testing what's working, what's getting a bigger impact, what's giving a bigger impact with less energy. That will end up giving you the freedom and more capacity to then pour into your customers, pour into your team, pour into your staff, pour into your marketing, so that we get this in on an ongoing basis that allows you more and more capacity, which is why you pretty much all started this business in the first place, is freedom, right?
Hell yeah. Everyone I've ever asked why to start the business, it sure the heck wasn't because I want to work 24 hours a day and be bound to my 500 customers and not leave the house or go anywhere. Which we appreciate right now.
Yeah.
So guys, that capacity is essentially your ability to take in new information. Do you have the ability when presented with new information to change your mind? Or are you going to stuck in the load is too big, I'm too busy being busy to make any kind of change?
Yep. I mean, here's the thing. We are right now in the most critical time of our generation in terms of the creativity and the ability for you to expand where your business is and where it was in January and where it is going to be in June is very different. So what's worked in the past really is now the past. We are competing right now, everybody on this call, you are competing with everything going on in the world right now, including your own brain. This call is all about shutting that brain, that chatter of why it won't work, down for just a few minutes to look at what's possible, what's out there on the other side of this that'll allow you to engage better with customers, better with referral partners, bring on those customers, and allow them to help you grow your business. Your business wants to grow. Most of the time, entrepreneurs are the ones that throttle back the growth of their business. The business wants to grow, and by you allowing more capacity into your life will allow the business to grow. I just put it differently, loosen the grip. Look at what's possible, loosen the grip, and let your business grow, for crying out loud.
That's real. You guys, when Casey said that what worked in the past may not work now, man, it's such a point of reflection to be able to analyze your business and rip it to shreds. Analyze your thinking and rip it to shreds. Analyze your strategy and rip it to shreds. If you don't do that, then you get in this hamster cycle of doing the same thing continuously, expecting a different result. We've all heard that's the definition of insanity. But in this environment, we have something that's not gonna change, and that's time. We're not getting any more. It seems like the day lasts a lot longer when you're sitting in the same
spot. Well, it does.
That's for damn sure. but outside of that, we don't get extra days. We don't get extra minutes. Our job is to create extra minutes by providing or thinking better, thinking faster, implementing things that are more high leverage activities in order to get results faster. We have to put more weight on high leverage activities and less weight on those things that are how we've always done it, time consuming processes, repetitive. You guys, when it boils down to it, the majority of, and this is Casey and I in a nutshell. Casey and I have hired the same coaches. We've been coaches, and we will never be without coaching. Having an advisor like Casey in my life and vice versa, it gives us the ability to uncover belief windows that don't serve you well. Your vantage point, whatever you believe is true, it doesn't mean you that it's true. It's just your version of something. So having someone in your life and your business and your strategy that will help you uncover those blind spots and figure out what principles are outdated that no longer serve you well. It's no different than when we were growing up. You hear these kind of old things, like your parents, your grandparents would say, eat everything on your plate, finish your plate, make sure your plate is clean. Probably not a good idea, right?
You're, there are a lot of people that finished a lot of plates.
Right? I'm still using that as an excuse for some areas. So we have to check the things we tell ourselves or have someone else check them to see if they're true.
And Jen, can I jump in here real quick? Look, you guys, here's the thing. I hear a lot from people just like you. One of the most common things I hear is, I hate technology. I'm not good at technology. And then I say, okay, awesome. Could you do me a favor? Could you quickly shoot me over a text and tell me that? And they take out their phone without skipping a beat and start texting me. And I go, do you realize that 20 years ago, you were doing a rotary dial on a phone, and now you're using your thumbs to send me a message to and from space? And you tell me you can't get through some technology of clicking a few buttons on a computer? I mean, come on. The reason you have coaches and advisors and folks like Jen and Mike and Kathy and Ryan and I around you is all we're gonna do is put an iPhone in your hands and help you click the buttons so you can go from rotary dial, skip a few pieces of technology, and send messages with your thumbs to space and back.
No, Casey, see, you know, I learned that first lesson from my son when I sat there getting frustrated that he hadn't got my email, and he had to remind me, Mom, It just bypassed the moon, passed NASA, hit a space station, it's coming back. Like, you gotta give it a minute. It had to go to space and come back. Like, my son is like, why are you frustrated with technology? Are you serious? Jasmine, no, my son reports to Jasmine, by the way. Casey, Jasmine is Terrell's boss. A whole new set of thoughts just went through his head.
Yeah, no, I don't know if you just saw, I literally was like going like this because I just had an entire employee folder open up in my head.
This is how long we've known each other.
We've done some write-ups on that Terrell of yours.
So, entrepreneur and mindset, change of thinking.
But hang on, Jen, I'm sorry, let me just go back here.
Yes.
Touching back to Terrell for 1 second, the reason he is such a powerhouse in this conversation is because he and his generation, which are the new younger generation coming up, they are within a year or two of being the primary decision maker in every credit card transaction, every subscription, every service contract is going to be determined by a young punk. We got to be able to talk to those young folks. Otherwise, we're going to end up in the relic station, which is called broke. And we're going to end up working for the Terrells of the world, and we don't figure out how to talk to, communicate, and hire them.
I remember it's with Lars and Andre. They told me that generation, you're either going to compete with them, they're going to buy from you, they're going to work for you, or you're going to work from them. So when I got that lesson, I decided to start real early and make them all start working at about 14, 16, and they've been working for us ever since. Like, if I got to pick one of those paths, I want to determine that destiny with intention. I just got a message from Terrell, who's sitting at the top of a mountain. You can see texting me from, I guess Jasmine gave him a half a day off. He's listening to our webinar from the top of Mount Si in Washington, and he just sent this message and said to say hi to all of you guys.
tell Big T I said hello.
I know what you wanted to call. All right.
I did. You caught that.
Change your thinking, change your results. The way you think today only gets us exactly what we have already. So if you love it, if it's perfect, if you're comfortable with it, then keep doing it. But if what you have already, how you live already, what your bank account shows already, what your profit margins are already, what your vacation schedule looks like already, what your employees are paid already, whatever all those things are that are judgments or what you consider success, how much time you spend with your family, how much vacation time you get to give your team. I mean, we're working right now, our whole team is working on one project that gives them the ability to work 4/10 from home for the next month. That's exciting. We have to do something different in order to get that. That's a big deal. Andre and Lars, oh my gosh.
I think I just saw that Andre was on here. I'm flabbergasted, that's awesome.
Yeah, so Andre Neal is on here from the Capacity Company, and he is the exact mentor and coach that taught us the capacity training. He's on this call, which I hope that he decides to join us as a guest presenter here, because man, I'm gonna read you a quote from Lars and Andre. You must learn, unlearn what you have been programmed to think. The software no longer serves you well. This is a new world, a new time, and a new space, and it requires new thinking. Right now. We could call it driving in the new normal, but in reality is, the program we have only gets us where we are. If we don't change it, we don't change. So this is, and I took this because it has so much meaning to it. Because when we start talking about technology, and we're not even to the good.
Uh-oh.
And we lost her.
She was just about to say, we're not even to the good stuff yet.
I thought that's what was about to come out too.
So the scenario here is, this is a guy out in the rain, and he's taking a deep breath, Casey. And is that mindset serving him well? That's where this slide's taking us.
Yeah, you know, guys, look, here's the thing. We're in a situation right now where the ability for us to crack out of what we did pre-March coming out of this is huge. And those businesses, those providers that can put systems and processes in place now and start down the path of putting them into practice, by the time we move through this and come out the other side, the game's changed. There's nobody's game in town. Let's see what we got going on here. Okay, sorry about that. You guys can still see and hear, yeah?
I can still see and hear you. I'm about to start sharing my screen for the presentation. Casey will go over everything together that way.
Okay.
A huge storm just knocked out all of their power and everything.
Yeah, no worries. No worries. We got all kinds of stuff going on here. This is what you gotta do. You gotta be able to roll through stuff, right?
Yes, I'm gonna bring everything up on my end right now, and then we'll just go through it.
Jasmine, thanks a lot for jumping in and grabbing that. We've got to be able to move, change, adapt, pivot, whatever that word is. But you guys, it can be done in layers. It's not like everything that is being done incorrectly or wrong. What we have the ability to do right here, right now, is to move and take one little piece and move it in a different direction. You know, when I was a kid, we had the DirecTV guys come out and install DirecTV at our house. And I remember having a conversation with the DirecTV guy that was out there putting the satellite dish in the front yard. And he was like, he was trying to line that up absolutely perfectly. And I kept saying, why are you being so specific with it, because that's a big space out there. All you gotta do is hit it out there and hit a satellite. And I will never forget that he said to me that for every quarter inch off they are at the ground on Earth, they are gonna miss the satellite by 400 miles. That's how critical or how big of a leverage point we all have in business right now. All we have to be able to do is take and tweak just a tiny bit, move the needle 5%, 10%, and by the time it gets over there, the old mindset is gone. It doesn't matter. In the same way that we went from a rotary phone to a touchtone phone, a touchtone phone to a remote control phone, a remote phone to an actual cell phone in a giant bag. Then the cell phones got super tiny. I don't know if you guys remember, but remember the point. Oh, I don't even have something this small as a cell phone. But remember when the cell phones back in the day were like this big and we're like, hello, hello? And now we're back to basically running an entire computer. I have to literally explain to my nephew that this thing, if you hit buttons in a certain sequence, somebody else will get it and they'll be able to pick it up and you can actually talk. Turns out it doesn't just work for text or Snapchat or Facebook or apps, but this is the communication device of all of our future.
I'll hop into that with you, Casey. I will say my son is 10 years old, and he's working a smartphone, he works my tablet, he does all these cool things in the fundamentals, and I mean, I'm not up there in age, I'm only 28 years old, but even the technology that has happened this last year has changed so much to people in my generation, my age group, the millennials. It's new and we're having to learn. It's not like how when we were 21, where we were just grasping things like there's no tomorrow. That has changed for us too.
Absolutely, and when we show you what's possible, you guys, what technology has done is it has really allowed us to create opportunities that were never possible when I was a young kid, right? And so here's the thing. When I speak and train all over the world, and I train at like a chamber of commerce, I look around the room and the folks there are my age group and older. When I go to technology companies or technology associations where they have younger marketing groups, all the kids are there and they got all this stuff on their desktop and they're running entire multi-million dollar businesses through the power of their phone. Doesn't mean that every single thing needs to go through your phone, but here's the thing. Those of you that are willing to change, just make a little tweak, the possibility is massive on the other end for you to capture, create, reactivate, win back, and serve your customers even at a higher, higher level. Being busy to be busy is really frustrating, right? The reality is that if you are somebody that says, I am so busy, then you're gonna love what we're gonna talk about today, because what we try to do, what Jen tries to do, what I try to do with our clients is create time, right? There are two things that every entrepreneur, just like you and I, are aiming for, and there's really only two. As entrepreneurs, our two drivers are saving time and making more money. The creation of time, using things like automation, technology, frees you up so you don't have to be busy, so you can serve your customers, serve your community, and for crying out loud, go play with your grandkids. And
time is freedom. I will jump on it. The one thing I always get from Jennifer is time is freedom. You have to count your minutes wisely so you have that freedom to enjoy the little things. And that's something that I've learned working here at Sam Web Group too. Kathy has pushed me to do the same thing. I have to use my minutes wisely to enjoy my time, because time is your freedom. We only have so much of it.
Absolutely, absolutely. So one of the things that we're gonna talk about today is how to change time. So, right, so we have these three buckets. We've got the desire, we've got competence, and capacity, right? And if you look at this diagram, what you're gonna find, if it goes back up, is that where you wanna live is right in the center of that.
You guys are awesome.
Right, and Jen, we're just rolling through, your presentation, we're just going.
That's some freaking pros for you, man. This second, I can't even see outside. It's crazy. We got a monsoon over here in the middle of Houston. We got our boat in the yard. We're ready to get in it. I got like 9 computers here, seeing which one has enough battery to stay with you guys. Okay. So hopefully we don't have this again, but if we do, you already know you're with a group of professionals that can continue. Desire, how bad do you want it? Like, literally, how bad do you want it? I mean, everybody that's on here, it's a group of entrepreneurs. So you got more desire than just about anybody. That's for real. A group of entrepreneurs have the desire. Competence, that's why you're attending training. Are you competent? Do you know how to get it done? The how-to, the tactics on how to get it done, that's the difference between I want to and I can. And capacity is, do you have the capacity to get it done without getting overwhelmed, without beating yourself up, without talking yourself out of it, without quitting before you even start? In the middle, that's where we get stuff done. How bad do you want it? Do you have the tools, the technology, the competence, the education, the knowledge, the know-how, the experience to get it done? Or do you have someone around you that knows how to do that? And do you have the capacity to manage it without freaking the heck out? When we have the desire, but we don't have the capacity, we do a really crappy job. When we have the desire, but we don't have the competence, it never gets done or it's really, really late. When you have the competence and the capacity as an issue, that's the avoidance pattern. That's when I say, if I could only get you to do what you already know you should, you'd consider me a genius. Also from Andre Neal, listening as a guest on today. So we need to be extremely strategic about our moves. We actually have to think about life. The majority of people walk through life unconsciously unaware that they're even unconsciously unaware, which that's mind-boggling. I don't even know that I don't know, so I don't know. We're gonna know. And we're gonna put ourselves in a position to be challenged so that people who do know can push us to go, hey, have you thought about, or maybe that belief window is not a good one, or maybe that's not helping you get anywhere, or maybe that's not serving you well, or maybe the fact that you have uncontrolled feelings is not helping you get to the next level. So, competence. First, let's break this down and couple this, and let's tackle each one of these. And this is why I brought Casey in, because, man, This is what people hire him and pay him a bucket ton of money to travel around the world and talk about. This is it. In our world, in the digital marketing world, we focus very, very heavily on new client acquisition and serving current clients. We are not an advocate of, even though it's in the 12-step roadmap, we don't have the best solution for, do we put energy into making sure that we don't forget your golden egg? When in reality, there are some golden eggs sitting in your back pocket that you're ignoring like crazy. We all do. We face this in our own business. It takes everything we have. And it's part of the reason why this pandemic has been so amazing for us is it's allowed us to stop, pause on the new client acquisition and travel and bring in a new business and to just sit and focus on our current clients. Casey, this model, when we break down our strategy to address current customers, past customers, new customers, and like you were talking about, Terrell, those freaking future customers who are wildly different than all three of these, why is this so important and how does this get, how do we fix ignoring these things as their own individualized strategy?
Well, yeah, I mean, Jen, here's the thing. This is like my favorite slide of the whole thing. Because if every entrepreneur just looks at this slide and says, okay, I need to have these four programs in place. From a marketing perspective, if you guys do nothing more than take a screenshot of this slide, you can be light years ahead. Because here's the reality. For current customers, we need to sell them more. They're the easiest group of people to buy stuff from us, right? So if you are doing, like the guys that do my air conditioning, HVAC guys that serviced me here in Los Angeles, right? They were coming out once every 6 months. I finally called them and said, can I please help you with the marketing plan? Because I need you to sell me what I want to buy. And they were like, wait, what? And I said, you don't have any way for me to give you money monthly. You don't have any way for me to not think and have you show up here and change out my air filters and check my air conditioning unit, right? That I said, you need, give me a monthly subscription that I can pay you $40 a month and I know I don't have to think about anything. So they did it. So for $40 a month, they come out every 2 months and change my air filters. They come out and do a whole, I don't know, they run around on the top of the roof, do something, I don't know, they click it with a hammer and, you know, whatever. And then if they have to give me any repairs, then because I'm part of their service repair subscription model, I get 40% off of parts or something, and I think it's 50% off labor. It's a great way for them to predictably have cash flow every month. And as a customer, I don't have to think, because you know what I don't want to think about? My air conditioner. Here's what I know. I live in Los Angeles. If that air conditioner does not work, the Marriott is getting a customer. Period. Right? Some of you are on the East Coast. It's cold there. So when your customer, their heater doesn't work, Marriott is getting a customer. Current customers are the easiest people to have give you more money if you will make some program that will help them do that. Past customers, number one reason that people leave a business, perceived indifference. They don't know you care. Somebody just gave you $10,000 to install an HVAC system. You don't care, they go away. Pure and simple. New customers, really important. You know, I don't know where you guys are in the world. Here in Los Angeles, houses turn about every 3 to 4 years. Every condo turns about every 3 to 4 years. That means whoever's gonna buy this place next is gonna need a new H system, a new air conditioner unit. It just is. Mine's about 7 years old. If there's somebody watching from Los Angeles, I'm sure you're about to take down where I am. But new customers are, these three buckets literally are the roadmap. And then on top of that, the future customers are the most important people coming up through the ranks. Go look at your grandkid. Go look at your kids. Go look at your nieces and nephews. Those folks, it's becoming younger and younger that they are investing in like cryptocurrency and the stock market, and they are technology crazy. These kids are buying houses out there, the likes of which my parents and myself were like, what? You know, now I live in Los Angeles, so I see what Snapchat owners are buying up. They basically bought up the entire city of Venice. You go down to Venice, they're all like 12 years old. They are your future customers. And by the way, it ain't gonna work to show up at the front doorstep with muddy boots, knock on the door, and just hope and pray that they're gonna give you 16 digits and an expiration date. Sorry, Jen, I was off on a little tangent. I apologize. I'm so excited about these. Business is so easy if we'll let it.
Okay, so here's all, I just heard 101 things to interject with. One, belief systems. The number of heating and air conditioning and plumbing and electrical and contractors that we talk to that believe no one will give them a credit card for a monthly recurring payment, but everything else in the entire world they pay for on a monthly subscription is mind-boggling. That is a belief system where because I don't feel comfortable, I don't think anyone else will feel comfortable. But I promise you, I could put a network of a million people on this webinar who would say, I don't want to think about my HCBA system. I have no clue what that is. I don't know. You know, I just messed that up intentionally. Because the other thing is, you have no clue what's included in your maintenance plan. I just listened to you say 50% off.
I completely pulled that out of my keister. I don't even know, because the convenience of it, whatever they originally sold me, the convenience of it was, here's what I know. I know for $40 a month, some dude is gonna clink around on my roof, and he's gonna come here and change the air conditioner filter thingies right here. I don't even know what they're called. I'm low tech, big check. So I don't even know what they're called, if they're called filters or filtration systems, or I don't know what the hell they're called. But so Jen, can I go off a 30 second tangent? This is just so important, you guys. Business owners, hear me, hear me just for 45 seconds and then we'll get back on topic. I know, having talked to tens of thousands of you, that your dream one day is to sell your business and retire and go off into the sunset and play with your grandkids on the beach of Costa Rica. I get it. But you wanna know something really interesting? When you go to sell your business, you know what somebody's gonna look at? ARR, annual recurring revenue. That's where the business is gonna be sold. When I'm a business buyer, I buy businesses all the time. I'm not interested in buying somebody's service-based organization where they make a sale one time and they just churn it and churn it and churn it. I wanna know the predictability of cash flow and the predictability of income through summer seasons, winter seasons, monsoon seasons, all of that. None of that matters when you have predictable and reliable cash flow based on a subscription model. The faster you get that in your business, the more value that business has for a buyer down the road, whether they're a small buyer, a medium buyer, or a big buyer. So just manage your business like you're putting it up for sale today. Make those decisions based on how you're gonna sell your business. You guys, we'll be running these things at way more efficiency, way more profitability, and way, way more time, freedom, focused.
100% agree. Question, future customers and new customers, there's an entire population of people that are raised with the ability to look up a product, look up a service, and be able to see how much it costs online. This industry has notoriously been the opposite of every other industry. If you are a big box retailer, if you're an Amazon, if you're a Home Depot, if you're Sears, are they still in business? If you're big box Lowe's, then they have no problem putting all of these systems on their websites with the price on it, a price tag on it. And then you have all of these local service providers who believe that transparency, it doesn't apply to them, that the consumer is not going to, or that the consumer who does go look up prices online once they have a manufacturer number, that might not be a good customer for them, those price shoppers. So who's coming up in the ranks that is sharp enough, smart enough, and educated enough to leverage technology to do a little bit of homework before they make a decision? And why is it important to figure out how to sell the service and the value of your service on top of the price of the box? Why is that important?
Well, it's important from a transparency point of view because the world is becoming more transparent. And those businesses that are not transparent, there's a word for them: out of business. That's just pure and simple. And here's the thing, I'll give you an example. Transformation happens in a nanosecond, you guys. And so here's the deal. Let me ask you a question. Which would you prefer? Your car breaks down on the side of the road. As a customer, would you prefer to have some mechanic stroll by and go, yeah, bring it down to the shop, we'll get it fixed? Your question is, well, how much is it gonna be? Well, just bring it down to the shop and we'll get it fixed. How do you feel about that? How does it make you feel it in your gut? Like, oh crap, I'm in a bad situation. My car doesn't work. I gotta go get it fixed. I got some yahoo that's the only guy in town screaming at me to come bring my car into their shop. I'm not being told what it's gonna cost. I'm not gonna be told what's wrong. They're just pie in the sky, bring it down, guess. Or somebody scrolls by and goes, oh, Mr. Jones, bring that car in and I go on a website or I can text the mechanic and he goes, yeah, Case, bring the car in. It's gonna max out at $500. It's gonna be between $400 and $500. Here's what we think it is, blah, 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 blah. Confused minds always say no, subconsciously, as a customer. When you go buy something, think about where you are when you go buy something and you don't know what it costs, or you don't know who's coming. Like the guys that do my air conditioning, we have an app. When they're on their way, I get a text with the driver's picture, a picture of his car. He rolls up here, he texts and says, I'm outside. Everything is handled through an app back to home office. The reality is, the more transparent the company is, the less confusion there is in the mind of the customer, the less confusion there is in the mind of the customer, the higher the likelihood they say yes before they even know what the price is.
That is perfect. All right, so same belief system. Social media is not gonna help me get found. SEO is not important. I can open up a business and have no presence digitally or put no effort into being present digitally and my business will grow. First, how do you use digital media in order to turn your castle into a magnet? That's you, Casey.
Sorry. I was
this was a beautiful video. You just got sidetracked by it.
Yeah, I was sidetracked by the video. But here's the thing, Jen, when you were saying that, what I just kept coming back to is the businesses that don't move into the digital world are not going to be able to retire. They're not going to be able to sell their business because someone like Terrell is not going to find any value in it. The value is in the digital assets. The value is in the database. The value is in the customer goodwill to the customers. The value is not in a dusty shop filled with trucks.
So this is 100% agree. So here's the difference, right? You can hire the progressive guy, you've seen him. You can make a sign and you can have him learn how to dribble a sign outside the shop, right on the side of the highway, side of the freeway, side of the street, side of the farm road, whatever it is. Or you can position your business so that people already looking for what it is that you want to buy or that they need can find you. You're either an option for the services you want to sell in the cities you want to sell it, and you turn your business into a magnet because you provide pricing and transparency and value and content and all of the information that they need, or you're not. Once they can find you, once you have, you mentioned two things. So one is, are you making yourself available to the consumer who needs the services you sell in the cities you need to sell it? But the second is, you got a database of people who already bought from you. And that database is not protected by grace. There's 101 other people out there trying to get attached to that database. So why don't we build a moat?
And here's the thing, Jen, I'm gonna use just a real life example. So you guys don't know this about me, you and I just met, but I come from the film business and I used to own an equipment rental company in the film and television world. So we rented traffic cones and wardrobe racks and water bottles and fire extinguishers and first aid kits and all of that stuff. That company, we sold that company for $1 million, okay? That $1 million price tag was divided equally into two different $500,000 chunks. $500,000 chunk was for the crap that was in the warehouse. The used cones, the used cigarette butt cans, the used director's chairs. The other $500,000, which I would argue is probably worth even more, was the database of every film producer, film location manager, every potential customer, and their home address. Now this is critical, their home address. Why? Because we became the vendor that sent birthday cards. So you called our office and it was, "Jasmine, thank you so much for calling. Before we get started, we are a company that loves to celebrate our customers and people that just call us. We love to send birthday cards. When's your birthday and where should we send the card?"
Get it, Jasmine. You just got an opportunity to get some brownies, bro.
Every single
I will message you.
Every single person gave us their home address. Now, if it was a lady and she didn't want us to send them in her home, she had the option by letting us send it to a P.O. box or whatever. That's why we said, where should we send the card? But when you can get out of somebody's inbox and into their mailbox, or out of their messenger, or in addition to their messenger, in addition to their inbox, you can get into their mailbox, gang, the game changes, because now you've got an extra point of leverage. So get really good at making your customers feel amazing, even when they don't buy from you, because those referral partners, those raving fans, will do more for your business than anything else, like hands down. Sometimes when I'm doing a big event and I've got, you know, a couple thousand people in the room, I always do this exercise. I always say, stand up right now. If your business is word of mouth referral based, 80% or higher. Pretty much the whole room stands up every single time. And I say, great. Now, I would like for you to sit down. If you cannot tell me by revenue who your top three word of mouth referral partners are, 99.9% of people sit down. There's the problem. You rely on something that you have no data and no tracking and no way to follow up with it. And if those referral partners are the ones bringing you word of mouth referral business, we better take good care of them. Could we send them a coffee mug? Could we send them some brownies? Could we send them something with our logo on it, with their name on it? Could we make them feel just a little bit awesome? Could we, I don't know, send them a birthday card? I send all of my clients a half birthday card with some cake. It cost me at least $6. So, you know, my iced venti soy latte from Starbucks that I can't have while we're on sweatpantcation goes towards solidifying a customer, putting a moat around my customers. My customers don't leave. They don't leave. The reason they don't leave is because they want to be made to feel special, and that's what we do. That's what we as business owners and entrepreneurs need to do, and here's the best part, you guys. Our competitors aren't doing it.
That's right.
The competitors aren't doing it. You know why? Because right now you guys are on here and they are, you know, sitting at home crying in their milk. I don't know if that's even the right phrase, right?
I don't know where that came from.
They're jumping around in a fish pond somewhere. You know, they're doing all kinds of crazy stuff. But focusing on how to take care of their current customers, reactivate, bring back past customers, and find new customers, and then go after the holy grail of all three of those is the younger customer that falls into all three of those categories.
That's real. You guys, what Casey's talking about is essentially, you gotta look at your database as your castle. Literally. Dodge Castle. When you look at that database, you open up Service Titan, you open up your CRM system, whatever you're using, and there is a list of human beings in there. Some are prospects, some are customers, some are subscribers. What we have to do is stop looking at them as, did they buy, did they not buy, or did they subscribe, and say, and are they a freaking raving fan? And if not, what am I gonna do to get them there? How am I gonna stay in front of them? How am I gonna build a moat around them so the next Yahoo trying to sell them and get that 16 digits doesn't have a chance in heck to be able to do it. Right now, you guys, here's a challenge. Let me just throw this out there. Every mindset produces a different result. there is a problem. So right now, the problem is different in everyone who's watching this now or in the future. The problem is I don't have enough time. So a fixed mindset is going to say, so I can't do it. A growth mindset is going to say, but I'm going to plan time to be able to get it done. And an innovative mindset is going to call Casey and say, hey man, can you get this done for me? I know there's a way to get it done, right? The problem is that we're on a quarantine or a semi-lockdown or whatever. The fixed mindset is going to say, this sucks, and they're crying in their milk for jumping in a pond, I think it was. Or the growth mindset is going to say, wow, I really think we can take advantage of this. A lot of people are not working. Some players in my market have dropped off. Let's step up our marketing. And the innovative mindset is going to say, how about we launch some new products and services that are virtual opportunities or virtual service calls or virtual appointments or auto ship filters or auto ship UV lights or e-commerce based solutions or drop ship products? Or how are we gonna get in front of this customer? How are we gonna, I mean, all of these things, they're gonna look at the pandemic as an opportunity to be able to go, you know what? We've ignored this castle, now let's get back to it. Same thing. Forget about the pandemic, move to the shoulder season. Casey said, if you're buying a business, I don't give a rat's rear end what part of the season is, if it's a shoulder season. So if you're in Florida and you only have a summer and a blip of a winter, which is not really a winter, it's just time for you to walk outside and feel comfortable or not. If you're in Florida, is that a problem that you have a shoulder season or that you don't have a real winter? Well, if your entire quote-unquote winter is no longer a problem, the fixed mindset is going to say, I'm not going to be doing any new installations because it's winter. The growth mindset is going to be saying, I'm going to be doing a whole bunch of maintenance plans. I'm going to get those all done during my shoulder season when I'm not busy. And the innovative mindset is going to say, I'm going to double up my communications to my castle, to my existing database, so that next year I have twice as many maintenance plans when the shoulder season comes. That's the difference in the mindset. And you guys, every single person, you guys should make a list of all the BS excuses that you call a problem. Just write them down, because a lot of those you don't think they're fixable. When in reality, all it is mentally deciding, do I want to have a fixed mindset, a growth mindset, or an innovative mindset? What would someone who believes everything is as it is and always will be, versus what is someone who says, okay, maybe I can make it a little different, versus what is someone's mindset who says, you know what, screw this, I don't care what everything already is, let's make something no one's ever made before, like a Tesla. Something entirely different. I'm totally sold on the truck, by the way, the Cybertruck, so I'm in Tesla land. Everyone thinks it's ugly, and to me, I find it as an innovative creation of divine intervention that I need right now.
Well, and Jen, literally 15 minutes ago, they just scrapped a launch of the same guy that came up with that truck, made a missile.
Right.
In 2008-2009, when it was arguably the biggest downturn in the economy that our generation is going to see, you know, give or take, two big companies came out of there that now we take for granted. Out of the worst financial crash in the world, I spent a lot of time in Australia, they are still talking about this thing like we are still in the middle of it. That's how impactful it was to the country of Australia. Airbnb and Uber both came out of that time.
Absolutely. The only reason Mike is on this call, my husband is down here sitting at the RV at the beach right now in his sweatcation, is because that launch of the spaceship just got canceled. So nothing like a little tornado to crash in on a fly to space and come back party, but.
They were gonna send, I was really gonna text somebody. I had given the piece of paper to the astronauts. They were gonna take it to space and bring it back and deliver it. That's a little technology, right?
That's legit.
It's our version of the Pony Express. It's the Astronaut Express.
That's rotary. All right. Client appreciation. You are the master at this. I don't know anybody. You and Kathy fall in the same bucket, I'm going to say. No one loves people more than you and Kathy. You and Kathy Marshall love human beings to the nth degree and back. And you have developed, you've taken it a step further, and you developed systems to show your appreciation, to build that moat, and to develop those relationships to create not new customers, not past clients, not future clients, not current clients, but raving, freaking fans who follow you like you are the next Motley Crue on stage, and you have groupies beyond belief, which I admire. You are amazing at that. Why is appreciation part of an overall marketing strategy, and how the heck do people turn that into a system?
Yeah, so I'll start with that appreciation is the marketing plan, right? So one of the challenges I think a lot of entrepreneurs don't do when they come up with marketing plans and strategies and ideas and tactics and all of this stuff that we go listen to webinars and learn about is sometimes it's worth stopping and asking ourselves, how do I want to be marketed to? Right? I don't know anybody that goes, oh my gosh, you know what would be awesome? Is if I got 900 robocalls in an hour trying to sell me air conditioners. Nobody in the history of the world says, oh my gosh, you know what would be really awesome? Is if every morning when I went into my inbox, I had 400 emails all telling me that someone's gonna save me $7.32 on my next $9,000 air conditioning unit made by some manufacturer that I can't pronounce their name. Nobody in the history of the world, as far as I know it, goes, oh my gosh, you know what would be really awesome? It would be really awesome if someone would just drive by and walk by me when I'm walking down the mall and screaming a website name at me. Even though I'm not really looking for it, I'm just trying to buy a pair of shoes, but somebody screaming an air conditioner unit manufacturer name and website at me. Turns out, we don't like that. But turns out that if I send somebody a really cool brownie that says something like, it was great connecting with you, and their name is on it for $4, turns out they go, and they eat it up. And then you know what they do? They're so blown away because nobody does that, that they take a picture of it, and that's what gets posted on my social media.
I've done it. I have posted brownies, cookies, popcorn, cups, pictures where you took pictures of me and Terrell and you put them, then you took a picture of Mike and I, and then when we got the Hawk's Nest, you sent us a picture of the Hawk's Nest boat, and every single time we staged it, we got the right lighting, we took a picture of it, and we posted online and say how much we love Casey and her.
Now, let me just pause this right here, right now. Wherever we are in this, if you guys could go back and rewind the last 45 seconds, and if Jen could have zoomed in on her face, what you will notice when Jen just started going off on her tangent on all the stuff I had sent her, she did not do it with a scowl or a pissed off look on her face. If you'll notice, what she said was, oh my gosh, you recognized me when I had the Seahawks, the Hawk's Nest, which is a boat, right? I recognized Jen with Terrell, her probably second or third most valuable possession, and that's her relationship with her son, right? All I did was recognize another human being for their contribution they made to my life. When a business does that for the customers they serve, in the community that they serve, magic happens. It just does. And your customers don't forget.
So question.
Yeah.
Did I have to call you and tell you any of those things had happened or were there? How'd you figure it out? How'd I get the picture?
Oh, somebody gave me a stick figure drawing that they carved into a rock, and they gave it to some guy on a pony, and he like trotted it down to Los Angeles. It took about 7 or 8 days, and I got it by Pony Express on stone tablets. Social media, guys, this is where it's at. It's very easy for me to go to Jen's Facebook page, yank off a picture of her in her new boat, or her and her son Terrell, and put it on a card, or put it on a mug, or put it on a greeting card, or I have lots of stuff here, or put it on a journal, right? I mean, this is about making your customers feel awesome, because here's the deal, you guys, our customers are paying us thousands of dollars that they probably don't have just hanging around to fix a problem in an immediate state when they are in crisis. It's 4,000 degrees and an air conditioner goes out. It's negative 70 and my heater goes out. At the end of the day, the appreciation will win out over self-promotion every single time. If you will make your customers feel appreciated on their birthday, you see one of your customers has a grandkid that hits a home run at some baseball game, and you can take that picture, put it on the front of a card, and send a card to somebody with a text where it'll show up in their mailbox. I pulled one of these, like, this is a water bottle, and you guys won't be able to see the picture on here just because the picture's really small, but this is a friend of mine who, he goes on hikes. He's actually a prospect of mine, not a customer, a prospect. I saw on his Facebook page that he was going on a hike up in the Pasadena Mountains. We took a picture, I put it on a water bottle, I put his initials on it, and I sent it through the mail. It was a $29 water bottle. You think he's ever going to forget how I made him feel when it comes time for him to do 16 digits and expiration date? And I've got a guy that sends somebody that sends him a water bottle or some brownies or reaches out and sends him a giant card, you know, something like this that says thinking of you with some puppies on the front. It's so low cost to what the upside is. It's low cost. High impact.
I sent this out.
Yeah, there you go. That's
the only picture I have in the house. The only pictures that I have in the house come from one of two places. This is Clay sent this card to me, and Mike. The only actual photos we have in our entire house nowadays either came from a cruise ship where we had a couple cocktails and bought it at the end.
I love your definition of couple.
Right. Or they came from you or Clay or our loan officer or our real estate agent who sent us a picture of ourselves or our family or a new houseboat, whatever, and sent it to us. That's it. And I see them every single day when I don't have anything else in this house that I would have ever printed myself. So, you guys, this is about one thing, right? Your entire database, you got to stay in front of them, because if you're not top of mind, it's fair game. Fair game. I know better. I know in our own world, we know. Jasmine will tell you, Scott will tell you, Mike will tell you, Kathy will tell you. We have an after-action review anytime a customer puts in a cancellation or decides, and they always send us a love note saying blah blah blah, and this is how great, and we love to stay with group and thank you for everything you've done and blah blah blah, but we're choosing to go another route or we're going to work with a local vendor. And in our soul of souls, every single time we do the after action review, we can pinpoint the exact thing that caused it, and 9 times out of 10 somehow we didn't stay top of mind, somehow we didn't stay connected, somehow we didn't stay in front of them, somehow they didn't feel enough appreciation from us to stick around and give us another shot. And it hurts our soul.
Number one reason that people will leave a business. Number one, perceived indifference. They don't know you care. What Jen just said of when they, the on the rare occasion that somebody goes a different route, it's because that customer was vulnerable to be seduced by another competitor that tries to convince them that they care more than Jen.
I don't like that at all. And I know it's true. That's why we have our after action review meetings. Because without those, if we don't dissect every single situation and figure it out, then we don't have the reminders to make sure that we have consistent processes in place to make sure that doesn't happen. Our retention rate in our company, our churn rate is around 2.9%. We hit 3% and my heart starts going thump, 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 thump. It's so important. The reason we do all these webinars, the reason we are working with you on retention and referral programs, all of these things are because I don't like 2.5%. I don't like it. It bothers me. So like, I want zero. I want no churn. I want customer for life. But it takes more effort than even what we're doing right now. We've got to improve. So, the new strategy for current, past, future, and new customers, it's got to include something that that makes sure that your database doesn't get ignored. Right now, the easiest thing for everyone to do is go through and make this list, right? Figure out the things, identify the things that are working. What are you doing that's currently working? Keep doing that. In fact, do more of that. What, and that's what comes up in these meetings, our after action reviews, is we will identify this keep doing bucket, and this is exactly how we go through. So we will use keep doing, start doing, stop doing, or we'll use more of, less of. What do we need to do more of? What do we need to do less of? Keep doing or do more of that are the things that are working. I know this works. You know this works. So in order to keep doing something or to do more of it, you got to turn it into a system. And as it gets bigger and it's working even more and your client base gets bigger, you don't want to keep having to add staff and employees and so forth to handle things. So you got to look for automation, you have to look for systems, you have to look for a way to implement it that's not going to be taxing and cost you more than the value or the return. Next, you got to figure out, what do I have to start doing? What am I not doing yet that I need to do? So right now, when you go through your current customers, past customers, new customers, and future customers, go through and look at, what do you need to keep doing? What's working? What do you need to start doing? Maybe one of those buckets is not getting the attention that it needs. And what do you need to stop doing? This is where you come up with cash, right? There's things you're spending money on that are total trash. There's things you're spending time on, total garbage. There's things you're thinking about, total waste of time. In fact, whatever you put your energy into, you're going to get more of it. So be very careful what you wish for. Right now, very, very, very cautious. You tend to attract that which you are. So if you say this won't work, guess what? You're right. So go through this process. Keep doing
this. I'll tell you, when I go through this exercise, even for our own business, when I look at the what do I need to stop doing, the biggest thing that comes up for me in my business is I need to stop pretending that I'm my own ideal customer and that everybody wants to be communicated in the way that I want to be communicated with. The reality is our customers, I don't know until they tell me whether they want to be communicated with text or Facebook chat or a phone call or getting something in the mail or some combo of all of those. Here's what I know. For me, I'm not a phone person. I'm a Facebook chat and text person. Jen, I know how busy Jen is. I know that I can send her a text and a Facebook chat. If I don't get a response in the next 35 seconds, I know I ain't getting a response for a year. Because she's super busy. I've got to be able to catch her in a nanosecond where her capacity is such that she can take on having a phone call. Right? Here's what I know. I do this exercise sometimes, and you guys, if you're grandparents, you might have this experience. Again, if I'm in a group full of like a chamber of commerce or folks where people are kind of over the age of, let's say over the age of 50, right? I'll say, how many of you right now would like to have a better relationship with your grandkids? Everybody, of course, raises their hand. I say, what's your number one issue with your grandkids? They never pick up the phone. They never want to talk, right? Because old school is grandparents want to call their grandkids every week, right? So I'll say, great, I'll tell you what, turn your phones on, and I want you to send a quick text to your grandkid. I just want you to say, hey, I'm sitting here thinking about you, hope you're doing great. Hey, I'm really proud of you, what's going on? And inevitably, Jen, within 30 seconds, the room is getting responses back, text messages back, and it is hilarious because on cue, everybody gets up out of their seat and they run outside because they believe that they're going to go outside and call their grandkid and their grandkid's actually going to pick up the phone and talk to them. That does not happen in today's marketplace. Those grandkids don't want to talk to you. That's not how they communicate. They communicate via quick text. Terrell is up on the top of a mountain. He didn't phone into Jasmine to deliver a message. He didn't even send a Snapchat or a TikTok or anything else. What did he do? He texted, I'm on the top of a mountain. Tell everybody I said hello. We have to be able to communicate with our clients and our prospects in the way that they want to be communicated with, and we may not know that. So the strategy or the plan of attack is find one customer, really create a moat around them by communicating with them in a multitude of ways, in their inbox, in their text messaging, in their Facebook or their Snapchat or their Instagram, in their mailbox. Do what it takes so that your competitors are being left in the dust.
That's real. Applying reason does not make it right. Jasmine, you oversee a group of 20-year-olds.
I do.
Here's what I know about them. As Casey alluded to earlier, they all stacked their change on Bitcoin when it flew out. In fact, I got in late and lost a bucket ton of money, and they all stacked cash enough to go pay cash for a Mercedes Benz. In fact, I know they're in their 20s and they have enough money to invest down payment in a house and are looking at the $500,000 to $600,000 rate. There's a whole bunch of things about who they are as human beings that make me crazy, sometimes slightly jealous. However, that group, they have expendable income and they think a little bit different. Jazz, as you're working with these 20-somethings, you have to change who you are to beat them where they are, or are you able to force them into corporate policy and make sure that they follow practices and systems in order to get it done?
I have to go with the flow. Terrell shows me a lot of things every single day, and I like the way that they work and the way their mind works, because I'm able to learn to adapt without corporate policy and have a conversation and an actual friendship with someone that I'm their direct boss. And that matters more to me. Being able to call Terrell whenever I want to, just to see how he's doing. I think that allows businesses now to go into a different direction too, because it's not where you're scared to call your boss and you're terrified that you're gonna get in trouble. Terrell called me, hey, I wanna go hike. It's gonna be sunny far. I'm like, okay, what's your pipeline look like? I just have this and this. I'm like, okay, that's fine, go. I have Friday off, you take today off. And it was great because we're able to build that friendship, to build the communication, to be able to be a little lenient with that. Versus if this was me trying to conform into how I know how to manage, it'd be like, there's supposed to be 2 weeks in advance, you guys have projects, like, no, don't come to me like that. But instead, he's been able to mold my mind to build a friendship and be like, okay, no, everyone needs that break, you guys have a break, go take a hike, go enjoy nature, because that's what they need. They need to be able to enjoy things just like how the world is moving to now. People in their generation, they don't want to work that 8 to 5 Monday through Friday every single day and push pens. They want to be able to have a little bit of leniency, a little bit of freedom, which honestly I think is what COVID has done for us, to be able to work from home and find that leniency and that balance.
So the funny part is, just for pure entertainment, they were texting me this weekend saying, hey, do you think Jasmine will let us take Monday off? We saw the weather's gonna be nice and we just want a half a day, we wanna do a hike. And I was like, how much work do you have to do? And they're like, we'll work all weekend. Do you think she'll say yes if our pipelines are clear? I was like, it's a good idea to work all weekend. That's mom, you know? So.
I find that funny, though, Jasmine, sort of, but I find that funny because he called me and he's like, hey, I'm like, hey, how are you? How are you doing? And I'm like, I'm doing good. He goes, I worked all weekend. I worked on Monday. He goes, can I have tomorrow off? I'm like, okay, how's your pipeline? What's everything? He's like, oh, it's clear. I'm like, okay. And then he texts me yesterday. He goes, hey, it's cloudy. Can I take the next day off and just work today? I'm like, okay, that's fine. That's fine. Just do that.
That's how it works, you guys. I mean, this is essentially this story. Well, it semi-applies to business because that is your next set of customers, employees, employers, or competitors. It's one of them.
Or buyers.
Right, or buyers.
You're going to buy your business. Terrell is not going to buy a business that does not have predictable cash flow to where he can't predict when he can go take a hike.
That's real. So be cautious applying reasons instead of getting results. Everyone has a really bad habit of trying to explain why wrong is right. Casey said a long time ago, I remember standing on stage, we were speaking at the same event, he said, you want to be rich or do you want to be right?
Pick one.
Pick one. right? I started paying attention because so my little particular activator kicked on and I become highly sensitive to people that are in the I want to be right version. And I start listening to the stories that they tell themselves to pretend that something's true when in actuality it's not, and it doesn't make you rich or right. It's just a story. That's it. Yeah, it's just a story.
I mean, look, we live in it. We live in this era. But the reality is, just because somebody says something over and over and over again doesn't make it true.
That's right. Gravity is true. Big building, jump from it, break legs. Like, that's true. Those are little things that are true. Most of the things we tell ourselves are not. So, fusion marketing. This is the time when I'm going to recommend that everybody take a little bit of a different process. Go back a little ways. We used to have an entire program called fusion marketing. The fusion of old school marketing strategies and new age technology. And I know Kathy's smiling over there because she was part of this mission over a decade ago when our entire business model cared about the existing database and new prospects in the digital space. And we cared about how people felt and how quickly we were able to move, right? How automated we were and how personalized we were. And right now, in the position we're in the marketplace we're in with the way people feel, we gotta go back to fusion marketing. We have to go back to high tech, high touch. We've got to get to the point where this becomes how we market. So with that, Casey, you guys, both of you, how the heck can they do this? How can they get set up? I know you have an entire system, an entire tool, and I have a way that everybody can get more information about that as well. I'll show you that. But what can they do to automate all these fancy-dancy widgets and tools and stuff?
Absolutely. So you guys, here's the deal. All I want to do is give you something of what's possible. So I'm going to tell you ahead of time that everything I'm talking about from here on out is a $49 decision. Okay? It's a $49 decision. Either at the end of kind of what I'm going to show you and kind of give you some examples, you're going to go, well, I'll throw in $49 into the hat just to be able to have the next conversation. Other of you are going to go, no, I'm going to keep doing what I'm doing. And that's awesome. If you are not interested and you want to keep doing what you're doing because you'd rather be right than rich, what I'd love for you to do is send Jen your biggest competitor. Because what we'll do is we'll go over and talk to them about the fusion marketing, and hopefully we'll help them help waste their time and their money. And then you can be rich, or you can be right, and I'm going to go help your competitors be rich. That's really what we're talking about here.
Woo! I'm going to breathe, I'm going to rub my ears on that one and say, woo-sa, and let you continue.
So here's the deal. We have, at our the time has come for us to be able, as business owners, to reach out in an automated format in a completely personalized and customized way in making our prospects and our customers feel amazing. Okay? So we have a tool, we have a program, a platform, if you will. It can tie into your CRM system if you want, and it can be handled completely separately, but it allows you to do some really cool things. The two biggest benefits that this program and this platform does is it is going to give you the highest level of impact possible with 100% message read. Okay? So when you and I send out an email, we send out that to our database, we have about a 20% open rate if we're awesome, which means that 80% of our effort goes unknown. But if I send a box to somebody and a box arrives at somebody's house in the mail, I defy you to get a box in the mail like this and not open it. Don't happen. I defy you on your birthday to go to a mailbox and see a birthday card that has an envelope that's customized with your name on it. It says, happy birthday, Jennifer, happy birthday, Jasmine. And they take out the card and it says on the front of the card, happy birthday. I defy you to not open that. It's impossible. The number one piece of mail people will open above a check is a greeting card. A simple 50-cent greeting card goes a whole heck of a long way. Can you send out 10,000 of them or 1,000 of them with one click of a button and personalize each individual one? Absolutely.
So hang on one second. We will offer to custom design an entire 12-month set of postcards and cards that cover these things, because I know these are tactical things that they've got to get done. You guys have to send out reminders for maintenance, schedule your maintenance. You've got to send tune-up reminders out. You need to send something that's appreciation, and don't forget to refer your friends. We greatly appreciate your referrals. You need to send something regarding being in business storms, virtual appointments, easy ways to do business with you. You need to do something to build your database, like a giveaway. Give away a koozie, give away a Yeti, give away something, right? A barbecue, a grill. Build your database, because the bigger your database is, the more this works. We will design all of those things at absolutely no cost, the entire portfolio for you.
If I own an HVAC business, the number one thing I would do is I would allocate a number of dollars per purchase that I would spread out over the course of a year. So if my thank you gift is $100, I'd spread it over 10 $10 card gift packages over the course of a year. That's how I keep top of mind. Most of you aren't even doing thank you gifts, so that's a whole nother, we can have that whole other discussion. But here's the deal. Think about this. Think about what it looks like if you were to send a customer a coffee mug with their name on it. And it can even have your logo. It's completely customized, 100% by you. The company will print it, put it in the mail, everything for you. This is going to cost you about $13. Is it worth $13 to have somebody stick their pens on their desk on a coffee mug? I don't know if you guys know this or not, but it is a physical impossibility for somebody to throw away a coffee mug. There's probably like 4 coffee mugs in all the landfills in the history of the world. Like, I joke that somebody is going to get really smart and just put their logo on coffee mugs and send them out, knowing that those coffee mugs are going to end up in thrift stores around America. It's literally called thrift store marketing, because you can't throw a coffee mug away. It just doesn't happen, right? But you could send out a journal. What if you sent out a personalized journal with your company logo on it, or better yet, the customer's logo, or something that just says, thank you, here's your maintenance journal. Write down any maintenance problems you have in your house. This is a whopping $11. $11, $12.
I love that, because that's a hard list to remember, all the little things. So in fact, you could send that as a maintenance journal. And then we have a Google Calendar that's already pre-built that you can share, that has all of the maintenance reminder notifications that somebody can say, add to calendar, and it'll add it to their calendar, and they can track all of their schedule. So we have to keep track of all of those things. It improves the valuation of your house. It improves the valuation of our boat. Keeping track of all the maintenance and items that you've done on your house, that's a fantastic way to help people do what they already know they should.
Yeah, I mean, you do coffee mugs. I did an event. I sent out, you guys aren't really in the event business, but we sent out a greeting card to 433 people talking about an event I did called Follow Up Riches. Out of 433, we had 210 people register to come to that event. Cost me 50 cents a greeting card.
So that would be fantastic for Tune-Up Special. Fantastic when events come back on and you're at a home show to say, come visit my booth. So they can participate in things.
Absolutely. I sent this out. I think I sent this to 1,000 prospects. So these are people that have not bought anything from me. But I sent out 1,000 of these. It said, take a moment to appreciate how awesome you are. Yeah, you. And on the inside, it just says, dear first name, wanted to write you a quick note to say that I really appreciate how awesome you are. Sincerely, Casey. That's it.
So for that, tactical approach for that, you guys are getting requests for new systems. You guys are doing a quote. You lose the business. Somebody else wins the business. They come in with a lower quote. They install a new system. What if they got a card in the mail and this is on demand? You have a campaign that is a follow-up for lost business. What if someone else does all the sales as far as new equipment, and you go offer the maintenance agreement, which is like a after install free safety check, and then you present the maintenance program that increases your MRR, so you have some monthly recurring revenue, And if you can put that in a campaign where every time you lose a bid, they automatically get a card, automatically the card says that this is a follow-up on the latest installation that you've done. If you want us to come do a free safety check, let us know. And oh, by the way, we have an incredible maintenance program to make sure that you protect the giant asset that you just installed in your house.
Yeah, I just thought of all kinds of things. You win the business, you go install it. What about sending a greeting card afterwards that says, thank you so much. Hey, here's our phone number. Here's our website. We're gonna call you on this day, but here's your machine number, here's your part number, here's your program. Now somebody can just stick this in a drawer and it becomes basically a maintenance guide. What if you sent a maintenance guide on the reason I don't know how to take care of my air conditioner? Because I don't care. Nobody told me how to take care of it. I don't even know what goes on up on that roof, right? I don't even know if there's actually air conditioner up there, frankly. But you can get your message read if you send that same thing in an email. Thank you so much for spending $10,000 with us. I really appreciate it. In an email, and it only has a 20% chance of being read, and the 20% that it is being read is probably happening in a line at a Starbucks or when somebody's having a glass of Chardonnay getting their nails done. Right? They're not paying that close of attention. It doesn't register. You send a greeting card or you send a box of brownies that says, you know, thank you, or a happy birthday brownie that says happy birthday on it. Or even just a big card, you know, with a big giant envelope on the outside with your logo on it, that they open it up and they get a big card and it just says a big giant thank you. Who does that? If not you, here's what's going to happen. Your competitors are. The reality is, and I don't know, Jen, how much you talk about this, but here's the reality, you guys. The company that can spend the most to keep and acquire a customer will always win. Let me say that one more time. The company who can spend the most to acquire and keep a prospect or a customer will win every single time. I'll just outspend you. Now that's why we take a little piece of that monthly recurring revenue, build in $5 for yourself to send them a thank you card every single month, or something cool out of that monthly recurring revenue every single month. They send you $49 or they send you $59. You take $6 and send them back a thing of brownie saying thank you so much for your order, and it's all on automatic. Automagic, as we call it.
Automagic. Stop on that. So right now I can feel the stress of someone like myself saying, oh my God, I cannot fit this into. How can they make this so that it's simple or automated or easy?
Have you heard of there was a guy and his name is, I don't know, Ron Popeil. Does anybody know Ron Popeil? He's famous for a phrase. Scott, what's the phrase he's famous for? somebody put it in the chat. What is Ron Popeil famous for saying? His entire career. I'm gonna send some brownies to whoever gives it to me.
Somebody better Google it quick. Where's our 20-somethings? They would have already Googled it, but look.
Ron Popeil. This is so important. This, Jen, this answers all your questions. This is what's so brilliant. This is how we blend old school hospitality and new school technology with the Ron Popeil model.
He was the king of the infomercials,
Set
wasn't he?
Set it and forget it.
Set it and forget it.
Yeah.
The Showtime Rotisserie, famous infomercial from the 90s till today. Set it and forget it. When you have systems, you guys, systems is an acronym for save yourself some time, energy, and money. It's a system. You click a button one time, they get cards and gifts from you for a year. Jennifer is going to build a 12-month card campaign and a 12-month postcard campaign that where once you put in the person's address one time, or better yet, you have them put in their own address, it's all done automagically.
So, you guys, these are things we can build bots for.
It is a bot. It's a giant bot.
That's it. That's what it does.
Literally. And so here's the deal, Jen. We're going to. I brought my buddy Ryan on here, and Ryan is a young dude. The reason he's a young dude is because he gets the technology piece. He gets understanding working with entrepreneurs to help get these systems and set up. So here's what we're gonna do. I just want to jump right in here, Jen. Here's the thing, you guys. It's gonna run you $49 a month to have this system. I put in the chat. The link for you guys to go check it out. It's gonna be $49 a month. Here's what I'm gonna tell you. You wanna do that before the end of the month. Here's why. Between now and the end of the month, the company is actually gonna waive a $297 setup fee. They're gonna give you 6 campaigns already inside your system. It's gonna be $49 a month. Here's why I said it was a $49 decision. When you go in and sign up for the gold package, so when you go to this website, on the right-hand side, you're gonna see a button that says join us. Click join, go down and click the gold membership. We've waived the $297, so that'll show up on there. We've already set this up for you, okay? And then what we're going to do is that program gives you free postcards, all you do is pay for postage. It gives you greeting cards for 50 cents. All you do is pay 50 cents plus postage. It gives you 25% off a bunch of gifts. There's a ton of stuff in there. Here's what we're gonna do. Jen asked me and said to me, look, I don't want these guys to have to do any work, essentially. That's why Jen said, I'll create 2 card campaigns and we'll put them in your account. I will have Ryan call you directly to make sure your account gets set up. I personally will cover the cost of having people on our team that do this all day long go in with you while you're on the phone, take information, and get you set up. It will be so painless. It will have such a huge impact. The reason I'm asking for you to make a $49 decision is all it does is allows us to know who to call first to get on this train, right? So bannerseason.com/CIWeb, okay? You'll go on there, you just click the gold package, sign up, it's gonna cost you $49, okay? Ryan will then call you in the next few days and schedule some time to get you kind of learn a little bit more about your business and get you set up. We have my team will actually go in and install things and get you all set up and teach you and train you the whole system. If it sucks and at the end of it you're like, this is not my bad, cool, cancel it and you're out $49.
That's like it.
I mean, my guess is you went to a $49 dinner at the Sizzler. At the end of the day, you guys, it is worth you giving this a shot because it's going to go back to the two things that we started this call with. It is going to save you heaps amount of time and it's going to make you more money in your business. We're just asking for an opportunity to show you what we have and asking for the opportunity to have you as a customer and see whether it works for you or not. There are going to be some of you that will get this right away and I'll be like, oh my gosh, this is the coolest thing I've ever seen. And there are other people that are going to be like, I don't want it. That's awesome. If you're one of the I don't want us, then just do me a favor, send us your competitors. It will be awesome. We'll have them go waste the money. We'll have them go try something new and see if it works or not. I'm being sarcastic, of course. Jen's
getting bold as you're growing up.
Yeah. But here's the thing, you guys. It's time. It's your time to blend the old school hospitality, the thing you and I grew up on, good customer service, a handshake and a smile, the service side, with systems and processes and technologies. We're at a crossroads right now. We've been around only for a few months. I had Jen sit down with the CEO and I told them both, I'm like, I know we're not ready yet. And when I called Jen and I said, Jen, we're ready. We got it. This is so dialed in. So it's either for you or it isn't. I'm just gonna ask for the opportunity to show you what we got and what we can do. We'll have Ryan and our team go in and help set it up and get you guys rocking and rolling. If it's for you, awesome. If it isn't for you, it was $49 and a month of fun.
So you guys, I specifically brought Casey on because right now the 12-step roadmap is so heavily focused on new client acquisition that it is mean to ignore our customers. It's just mean. It's across the board. So I want to make sure you guys have an opportunity to find and be able to implement a system that we believe in, we trust, we use. We've been a customer of it, getting those same kind of gifts and cards for many years. And I know what it feels like to get that. And I am the queen of no junk mail. I am the queen of no garbage, but I'm also the queen of that's the only thing I've ever opened. And I'm so excited when I get it. It makes me really happy. And I know your clients would be happy too. So we want to take this moment to really stress that now is the time, when you're busy, to let's get this system offloaded and make sure that we're not ignoring your castle. We're not ignoring your golden egg. We're not ignoring the people who matter the most, which are your current customers, your referral partners, past clients, prospects. Let's re-engage them. So let's get this going. I guarantee you, if you were in business 5 years ago and you didn't, maintenance plan was nothing that you ever offered, those people don't know you have one. Those people don't know you have a tune-up special. Those people don't know that those things are in place. So now's the time to re-engage. Ryan can help you take those customer lists and figure out how do we get those client lists in. For everyone who bought from us but didn't sign up for a maintenance plan, that's a campaign. For everybody who bought from us and signed up for a maintenance plan and want to automate getting those maintenance agreements on schedule so that they automatically book when they're supposed to, let's get that campaign on. For everyone in the database as a whole who's not on a maintenance agreement, they need to get a tune-up because they have no clue what's happening on top of their roof. That needs to happen every spring and every fall. Let's get that system on lock, on auto delivery. You guys have like 6 or 7 real specific things in your business that are taking place day in and day out, with or without you. Let's be intentional about what we do. Put a system in place to cover the business processes that right now you're ignoring that are costing you time, money, and energy. Let's get those things taken care of with that. I love you guys so much. So great to have you on the call today. Thank you. Welcome to Reinvent. Make sure you register for the next webinar. Casey, Ryan, we all hope to see you again on this call soon. Thank you.
Absolutely. You guys are awesome. Let's go out and do it.
Thanks, you guys.